You know, the hard part for me is how far do you go? And we have clients who come to us and say, oh, we want to promote our greenness, and we ask a lot of tough questions, and then we, you know, they realize that they don't really live up to it, and hopefully, and then they go back and they make changes. But that causes you to self-reflect. I mentioned that we do this conservation campaign. We're going to do a water conservation campaign. One of the things that's always concerned me is I think the kids are really important. I mean, my daughters have changed my habits in recycling and seatbelts. And historically, you know, the nag factor is a really big part of getting people to change their behavior, especially in the household. And it was disconcerting to me that global warming and the role of sustainability is not taught in the schools. And that came home over and over and over again. It was taught as a curriculum like 5 years ago. The people that we work with said, oh, we've already done that. And I said, well, it's a new crop of kids and there's new facts out there, right? And can we still be teaching that? And well, we could. So anyway, I had to put my money where my mouth was. So I'm paying a curriculum writer to develop a curriculum about climate change for middle school and high schools. And you know, that was a lot of you know, chutzpah, but we're going to get it done because I thought it needed to be done. And it's done from a activist point of view. It's getting kids to be climate change activists, and it's all project based, so they learn from different ways, not just the teacher teaching. And you know, lo and behold, you do good things like that. Looks like the UN is interested in promoting it, and may in fact get it promoted in the United States. But that's tough, you know, when you have to lay out your own money to, but you know, the question was, are you really going to be authentic to this? Do you really believe in it? And it isn't just about big television ads and billboards and interactive. It's got to be in a lived and breathed in the home. So yeah, it holds your feet to the fire sometimes when you want to be that authentic.
I would imagine. And well, we're the current, do any of you find that your job is getting maybe even tougher in ways you hadn't imagined because of the current political and or economic climate with everything that's going on? If you have any insights as to how that's influencing you, I'd love to hear them. Perhaps with budgets, perhaps getting...
Well, just waiting and seeing, I think, holding our breath, right? I mean, yeah. Has it hurt on the television side?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, well, there's two ways. It's certainly hurt on the television side, and you know, outside of just sustainability and green aspects, is that, you know, I mean, everybody's wallets are getting tighter, and you know, all of those. I think it's hit everybody in every industry in some form. But I think that I think we have a big challenge. I don't know the answer to this in terms of in the green movement or the sustainable movement, is that, you know, people's minds are everywhere else. It was kind of like you know, Al Gore lit the fire that, you know, everybody saw and created this beacon, and now we're in a little bit of we can't see it so clearly anymore. And, you know, that's not the fault anybody who's not thinking about it, because people have big personal issues, you know, concerns at the moment. But I think it's a tough thing, and it's a challenge for the media industry to remind people that there, although the problems that are going on literally today and tomorrow are a big issue, that, you know, whether it's in an election or whether it's in, you know, whatever choice you make in your life or your business, that you still have to look 5, 10, 15, 20, 50 years down the line and think about, you know, what kind of state are we going to be in and our kids going to be in, you know, 20 years from now, if we just keep thinking about the present in the present tense so much. So it's an interesting, I mean, it's one of the things I was really interested in thinking about for this panel, is what, you know, how do you keep that momentum going when sort of pop culture and the general climate of your audience, you know, isn't as inclined to be as inspired right now?
Yeah. Well, the way I personally look at the problem with communication is that people are tuning things out because they think you're trying to make them feel guilty, or because they feel that they don't have the resources to deal with it. It's a challenge, but the urgency is real. So it seems to me that there should be a solution to where people can see that our shared interest is at stake. But we have such different value systems and ways of looking at the world. So that's a topic that I'm fascinated with, and I'd love, in particular, Renee, The psychology of the tough consumer, I know that you've done some research on the psychology end, and I think, because in this room, it was a pretty much a shared value system. We value transparency, a lot of these things, but there are people who the word authenticity doesn't mean much to them. About 50 million people voted for our current president, you know. So how do we get through to these people? You know, what kind of challenges do we have, and what kind of insights does your research shed upon that?
We conduct a study of all the Californians twice a year. We talk to about 1,200 of them. We do mainstream, and then we do across a lot of ethnic groups, Chinese, Vietnamese, Korean, Japanese, et cetera. And one of the things I'll tell you right off the bat is those ethnic groups are much more concerned about environmentalism and are much more actively engaged than most of mainstream Californians, which is interesting, including the Latino population. There's a great respect for nature and an understanding that we've been screwing it up for a long time. And they really hold a higher standard than does the mainstream audience. But when you look at the mainstream audience, there are six segments that we see in the marketplace. Two of them are highly engaged. One is what we call family and future. That's about 22% of the population. And there are people like most of us up here, you know, who are concerned about the legacy in our children and are very worried about what's going to be left behind, some of the thoughts that we've echoed here. Then there's home and hearth, people who are really focused on their household and the cocooning kind of phenomena that I think you're going to see more of as we go through these tough economic times, where people try to create quality time within their home but don't have a lot of money to be able to do that. And that's where the values come into play. As you said, their mortgage is a concern, the cost of food is going up, the cost of gasoline, how much can I really contribute, or can I put off maybe some of my green behaviors. Then there's two really tough segments to reach, and I'd love any insights into this. One, it's about 40% of the population. They are largely in Southern California, and so my colleagues in Northern California try to relate to them, because Northern California by far is much more environmentally conscious and engaged in the behaviors than Southern California. The one group is the achievers, and when I have to explain it to the Northern California people, it's like the typical Los Angeles person. I'm sure none of you in the room represent that, but I bet you know friends of brothers, sisters, and relatives who are more concerned with status. You know, they might have a Prius, and they also have an old Mercedes-Benz and a BMW, and probably an SUV or a Hummer has been in their yard or their backyard or their garage at some point in time. So the Prius is a status symbol, but it's not really a part of an authentic lifestyle. Another group that's part of that 40% are the frugal strivers. And these are people who are really working hard, and money is a big issue. And saving $6 or $7 on their energy bill just doesn't seem like it's worth than buying those CFLs. So it's making those trade-offs and motivating them. And then last, we have about 20%. We have some people called the live for todayers. Tend to be really young, very hedonistic, and it's like, what can I do? I live in an apartment, it's not my problem. We use whatever as kind of our catchphrase for them. So you can see how the psychology is different for each of those groups. And, you know, it's different kind of messaging to motivate them. But frankly, you know, one of the things I'm excited about is I think popular media is a powerful, powerful tool. And if we can make it cool for those achievers, you know, to be able to reduce their use and be proud of it. One of the water people said to us, because we're going to be doing this water campaign, he said, you know, what do I do? And he represents a part of Orange County. And he said, we have homeowners who spend $2,500 to $3,500 a month to water their lawns. And he said, it doesn't matter how much we charge them, because in some parts of the state, you pay more if you use too much. And he said, what can you do for those people? And, you know, it's a good, you know, how do you make it cool that they've turned off their water when, in fact, they love having all those flowers and plants and all those flowers replanted? It's a real challenge because it's become a part of status. You know, you show your wealth in Southern California in particular. So I'd be very interested in ideas in terms of how we motivate people and how we make it cool.
My cactus is really expensive.
There are other indigenous plants, California-friendly plants that are less water-consuming.
Michael, your magazine.